Technicolor is staying at the forefront of whatever technology and absorbing it. And because I think that's the nature of the company itself. I mean, Technicolor itself is a technical innovation of how things are normally done, and they were always in the forefront. So when we did my first DI included recreating Technicolor. So back then they were at the forefront, always wanting to embrace something that hasn't been done before. And then now working with them again, they were the same way. And there was never any hesitation about doing something that hasn't been done before. It was embraced as opposed to discouraged. And I've worked with other companies very much try to discourage you from doing something because the sheer fact it has never been done before. And that's the opposite of the experience at Technicolor. Everything that I was trying to do is to recreate the movie photographic experience of real life, not even necessarily real life, but how one photographs something for a film. So your sense memory, again, is it feels like a movie. It doesn't feel like a special visual effect shot or anything else, so that you then get divorced into the fabric of the film. What I did for Apollo was I would show people the stock footage of the launch, and it's very inspiring because you remember back in the day when it happened, and you sort of fuse your memory of how grand it was and what was really occurring with the vision that you're seeing. And then I discovered that everybody altered how they described what they saw, and it was really interesting that because they were emotionally wrapped up in it, they described it with better lighting and camera moves and all these various things that were not really what the stock footage I just showed them was. So then it became the idea, it's like, well, maybe I really shouldn't recreate exactly what happened. I should recreate what you remembered happening, because that's the one that you're going to connect with, not that visual. You're going to respond to how you felt about it. So for an audience to see it for the first time, I thought, well, maybe that's the interesting tack, is to recreate what you remember, not what you actually saw. Dave Scott, an astronaut who was our advisor, came in to basically make sure that our science was correct and all that stuff. And so he sat in a big screening room, and everybody was excited because he's a giant hero. And so everybody came into the screening room to hear what he has to say about our wonderful footage. And we play a shot, and he said, that's wrong. It's like, well, what do you mean it's wrong? Because a rocket wouldn't do that. I mean, you can't have your arms moving while the rocket's going up. I mean, that could be a terrible tragedy. It's like, well, it happened. And he said, no, who would design a rocket like that? I said, well, at that part, I can't help you with, you know. So, but I went into the screening room, and I found the stock footage that we were studying that this was emulating, and I played it for him. And he looked at it and goes, that's wrong, too. It's like, oh, I'm sorry, Dave, but that's the real thing. And quite frankly, that was the mission you were on. That was Apollo 15. So maybe since you're inside, you didn't really see what was happening outside, because it probably scared you to death. But then you know you're sort of on the track of recreating something that somebody believes to be real. Buzz Aldrin came up to Ron Howard and asked him, after he saw Apollo 13, which vault did they get some of that stuff? He hadn't really seen any of that stuff before. And Ron Howard said, well, Buzz, there is no vault. We created that. And he said, he sat there for a minute and went, can we use some of that? So it's like, yes, you can, Buzz. You can do whatever you damn well please. There was something mesmerizing all your life growing up and hearing about the Titanic, and then the fact that you actually found it and could float down to this mystery thing that's been hidden for so many years and all that stuff. So it's kind of a magical journey, very difficult magical journey, but it was a magical journey nonetheless. Jim had showed me some of the spectacular footage he shot for real, and then you look at some of the photographs and the ghostly photographs from below, and your brain sort of pictures it coming to life. You sort of create almost, you almost could see people on the deck of the ship and all that stuff. And so all those transitions and all those things came out of strictly looking at that and just wishing it to be. It's almost like we're dreaming it. And I literally, to judge those shots, we would place them in the screening room again, bring people in and say, where are you looking? Tell me when you start to notice that it's starting to change. Where do you see it? And every day it would alter and change, because as you're looking in the center, the periphery is starting to change. And then as soon as you notice enough, you start to look to the periphery, and then that's when the cue is we change the center. So at any one time while you're watching it, you don't see where the effect started and stopped. It just sort of melted, as if it's something that's psychological happening in your brain, just morphs into this. I use that idea, the psychology behind photography and transitions and effects. And, you know, movies are kind of dreamlike. They're not real life. Their movie life is different than real life. It's what we remember, what we imagine, and all that stuff. So that became very helpful in not being so factual about how one photographs something or how one creates a sequence. It's you tap into the psychology of the person who's watching it. I saw something that this company called Arete did, which was from satellite pictures. They would look down and be able to ID what a Russian ship was by the wake it created. So they had to simulate what could have caused it. So in the process of creating these simulations to fingerprint these Russian ships, they created simulated water and all the same properties and stuff. And so I looked at it, and it wasn't very artistic, but the backbone was there, and that's when I decided that for me to do these transitions that I spoke about, these magic transitions where you blend from one thing to another, I needed to essentially motion control water. And that's the one thing you can't do. You can't motion control a helicopter, and water doesn't scale very well. So that was kind of the cornerstone of trying to get it to work, and that was the linchpin to doing the type of work that I wanted to have done on the movie, and Jim wanted to have done too, of course, but It was that. So we just forced Arete water into a production tool that became, you know, how we shot the movie and how we changed how one shoots a movie like that. When Aviator came about, it was like it was a subject matter that I would die to do. I would die to work with Marty in a legitimate film. I went to his hotel room he had at the Bel Air at the time, and his first question was asking me if I knew anything about three-strip Technicolor. And being an immense fan of three-strip Technicolor, I said, yes, I do. And he asked me, he goes, well, have you ever heard of William Cameron Menzies? I said, well, yeah, William Cameron Menzies is the production designer on Gone with the Wind. In fact, the name production designer was accredited to William Cameron Menzies because David Selznick felt art director was not a good enough title for somebody who created the look and of the film. And then he asked me about two-strip Technicolor, and I happen to know about two-strip Technicolor because not too many people do. And I think I sort of sold the job, in essence, because I had I loved the idea that I was going to try to recreate Technicolor and two-strip Technicolor and work on a film about Hollywood and Howard Hughes and the whole bit. It was just like a dream come true. Something I did on Aviator, there was a plane crash in it, and I've never photographed a plane crash before, and I didn't want to blow it. So I used the computer and a hand-operated pan and tilt wheels that you'd use like on a regular, like a Lumacrane or whatever. I hired another guy who was able to take the signal from the pan and tilt wheels and actually drive Motion Builder, which is, we're still using it today, to basically, so I could live in real time, photograph a plane crash. Now I would design what I thought the sequence should be like and keep on shooting all the various angles. Just repeat the same action, shoot it with a 14, put the camera down lower, have the plane come overhead, isolate close-ups of the tires hitting the roof, all the various things that you see in the thing, and then cut it together and go, oh my God, that's horrible. I can't show this to anybody. So let me fix it by going back and reshooting and creating now the experience of doing it more than once. I found a rhythm that seemed like, well, I can picture that happening for real, and I think I made the bed of a good sequence. You know, so I knew what I was doing. I didn't create a shot that I couldn't get. I was creating a shot in an editorial rhythm that I could actually reproduce. And sure enough, it worked as a body. So I said, well, this is a fabulous way of working. The only part that was difficult about doing it was that I couldn't control the actor. We had a puppeteer, Leo, in the cockpit, so the shots I was getting of him that I was later going to reproduce in live action were not very accurate because the puppeteering wasn't that great. So it's like, well, if you brought all this to a motion capture stage and you were had full control of it, then you could also take it out of the wheels and have a handheld camera so I could walk around and then I could actually talk to the actor that's appearing in the virtual world. Boy, you have everything. You have the template for how to make not just a scene that you're going to replicate in real life, but actually be able to direct a CG scene like you would direct a live action scene. I got this opportunity to do Yugo and to recreate, you know, basically the one of the fathers of certainly the business that I've been employed in for a while, specifically the effects area, and then, you know, just movie making in general with the Lumiere brothers and the invention of film, and to do it with such a film historian and appreciator of past work and appreciation of the talent that went before, and was just like another dream come true setup that not that I would ever pass it up, but that you could never pass that up. You would do whatever it takes to actually do that job. It was a joy. It was one of those few moments where the fusion between the subject matter, the people who are working on the movie, and what it ultimately is going to become, what you're creating, was so together. And you know, working with Marty is particularly great because everybody then supports the filmmaker making the film, and everybody's ego gets removed from the process. Everybody was helping each other because helping each other also helps the movie. And so it became one of those blessed events that it was one of my favorite movies and one of my favorite movie experiences. And it celebrates the history of film and realize what a genius these guys were back in the turn of the century. Just even my Technicolor recreation days, the study of the history of things, realize the genius that went behind everything that went before us. So we all take advantage of you know, the incredible skill and acumen that these people who started with nothing actually produced, and we just go sit on top of their shoulders essentially and produce it. So I've always had this fascination with how smart people were when you study how they did what they did and what tools they had to do it with. A big difference between, you know, photographing something in real life and then photographing something for a movie. There is a different interpretation, different spin on it, to make something look very natural, even though it's artificially lit, is an art form. That's what cinematography is. What we're doing is not recreating a photographic thing as if you shot like a documentary. This is we're creating something that feels like it fits the drama of the movie. And that's where everything, you know, all roads lead in that way. My early discussions with John is John's a very firm believer in photoreality, and any chance he can do to make something look real or shoot a real model instead of a CG thing. That's his sensibility. I think it's also easier to determine what was working, what's not working. So we decided early on that it was going to be an absolutely photorealistic, photoreal version of Jungle Book. It's not going to be an animated film that has heightened animation. It looks like we grabbed a camera, went out, photographed a real animal that happened to talk, and staged these scenes with a kid just like you would in a very conventional way. So that was the idea behind the making of the movie. And then and we were in agreement that's what he wanted to do and that's what I wanted to do. And so it became like a good marriage there of enforcing the same idea. It's exactly what Avatar was or wanted to be, now done in this other photorealistic way. I mean, what Jim did, it was a sort of photorealistic version of Pandora, but it's also a land that you've never seen before. It's larger than life. It's brighter and colorful. The creatures that are in it are things you haven't seen before, so you have nothing to compare it to. And what I was interested in is doing the same thing, except now doing it with things that you are a judge and jury on whether it looks real or not, because you've seen various pieces of footage or other movies or things like it. So that challenge, that idea of telling a story in that way, separates it from trying to imitate an avatar or another thing like it. And also, I thought it was the proper telling of this particular story.
Come on, you're my brother. You have to play with me. Let's go chase some mice.
When I first introduced to Bill, we brought him over and I showed him how one shoots a virtual camera scene. You know, you pick up a camera, you change lenses, you tell the operator, I want to put me on a dolly, I want to go from point A to point B, and you start doing shots, and very quickly you could rack up 5, 6, 7, 8 shots, which are long dailies, and then we have an editor standing by and could cut it together and say, well, here's the scene that you just imagined that you were able to see back to you in that time. And he asked me the question, which is like, well, what do you need me for? And it's like, well, we need you for your, you know, 30, 40 years experience of picking up a camera, determining what's the best angle to tell this particular story. All those things, all everything that you've ever learned is what we want. It's your years of experience as a DP. Artistically, what would you do? And want it to feel like it's a photographed movie. It doesn't want to feel like it's a computer-generated photographed movie. It wants to feel like you actually picked up a camera, and which is what we did. And so it was a very rewarding thing. And he had a very specific point of view of how he likes to shoot action scenes and how he likes to do this. And when I would do my versions of those scenes, I would make sure that it felt like it was one brain coming up with the photographic construct of how we would shoot. The association we had with MPC was probably the best relationship I've ever had with a visual effects company. Adam Valdez in particular is a very gifted guy, extremely smart, and also all he really wants to do is to make the product the best it can be. For me, you know, and I'm a little biased perhaps, but I think the critics will bear me out. It's probably the best, most realistic animation I've ever seen. The nuance, the subtlety, the lack of trying to create a movement or thing that can't happen in real life, that defies physics, which I don't care for in animation, why it kind of animation has a connotation to it. To even call this animated would be doing it a disservice. So I think they've got to the art form so much so that you can't even call it what it used to be called. As a overall supervisor for the film, the job became somewhat easier because what I would have to judge was already, you know, A, and we're just trying to make it A plus. And Adam is the one who actually did the technical portion of it. I just asked for it and asked it with him because he felt that it was the same thing. Is we just basically based everything off the Alexa curve, which is based off of film curve. And all the CG was done with the same Alexa curve, everything. So when we got into the high dynamic range portions of the film, it just fit in so perfectly because the concept from the very beginning that Adam put into effect at MPC created the backbone, which is as if we photographed it. Technicolor itself is a technical innovation of how things are normally done, and they were always in the forefront. So when we did my first DI included recreating Technicolor, and Josh Pines and Steph Nakamura at the time, you know, lovingly did that, and they embraced something new that it was definitely not done before, creating these lookup tables and things to alter the way film is shown on in our movie. And then now working with them again on this particular film, they were the same way. And because there's new technology that's being introduced as we're making this film, which is high dynamic range, Dolby laser projectors, IMAX laser projectors, 14-foot Lambert, 3D in Cinemark theaters, 4.5 and other IMAX things. And otherwise, there's so many different versions or flavors of the movie that needs to play as perfectly as it can and all these things that, among other things, the Technicolor staff was so great is organizing the work in such a way that you ripple what we call the master color correction of the movie into all these other permutations in a fairly seamless way. So as we were watching the next version, behind the scenes, they're trimming and doing all the various things that one needs to do, and then what you're looking at is the best version for that particular screen or that particular venue. And then we got the Dolby projectors in Technicolor so we could actually do it correctly and not guess what it's going to look like or have an overall trim. It's actually color time it using this new technology that is, you know, mind-blowing. And Technicolor's handling all of that and all of the color pipeline.